Thank you. Thanks. So thank you guys so much for being here. This is our keynote conversation on looking back at girls' games. I'm Rachel Simone Weil, and joining us on the panel, the amazing and trailblazing, might I add, Brenda Laural, Emma Westecott, and Megan Gaiser. Just to give you an idea of how the panel is going to go, our little schedule, we're going to start with some introductions of our panelists, and then we'll get into the panel discussion. And we're going to leave a pretty good portion of time for audience Q&A, so please write down, remember your questions as you have them, and we'll try to get to everybody. So I'll just start off briefly by introducing myself. Again, my name is Rachel Simone Weil. I'm part of Austin's indie game collective, Huegos Rancheros, and I help organize another little indie games festival called Fantastic Arcade, which some of you may have been to in the past. I'm also an experimental game developer working primarily with the original 8-bit NES, and my work kind of is in rewriting the history of girls' games by creating these girly NES game cartridges that never existed, and especially for a console that was primarily marketed to boys in the US at that time.
We know that story.
I also am a lecturer at the University of Texas at Austin, teaching a course on video game history and critical theory. And finally, in 2012, I founded FEMICOM Museum, which documents the history of girls' games, software, and electronic toys. And part of my reason for founding this is that I felt like a lot of girls' game history was being lost. And a lot of the documentation that did exist online was a little mean-spirited and also a little inaccurate, or sometimes very inaccurate. So it's often not nuanced, and I kind of wanted to bring a more academic, nuanced look at the history of girls' games. So that's a little bit about me, and I'm going to let the panelists introduce themselves, starting with Brenda.
Hi there. This little slide is about a little consulting venture I'm involved in right now to assist designers, developers, and companies with issues involving diversity, social justice, earth justice, doing the right thing. I figure I'm 65, I can do whatever the fuck I want. So, and I've got some great associates lined up, and if anybody's interested in joining the party, let me know. Back in 1992, I joined Interval Research Corporation, and was at the time designing and producing a virtual reality piece called Placeholder at the Banff Center for the Arts. But my real job at Interval was to lead a research project on girls and technology. And it's important to express clearly that this project is historically situated, okay? And then if we were looking at doing something like this today, we'd probably do something very different. But in 1992, you would look in a computer lab in a middle school or whatever, and the girls would be in the back, and the boys would be hogging the machines. And there weren't games out there that girls were really into playing. There was a pretty large audience for first-person driving games and text adventure games among older women, but little girls were not enticed into the digital realm. And our concern initially at Interval was to come up with some insights that might help us develop things that would entice girls to put their hands on the keyboard and see that it was okay. Knowing that boys had the experience of, you know, hitting return 50 times and something would happen, whereas girls would say, I'm gonna break it, I don't know how to do it, you know, and they'd sit in the back. So the idea was to learn enough about girls and play, especially in the middle school, or, you know, sixth grade to eighth grade range, where girls will fall off the wagon in science, math, and technology in that period if we don't save them from that or make it attractive to them. So we interviewed over 1,000 kids in 8 U.S. cities. We interviewed 500 parents. We interviewed people who were play theorists, scholars in the area, developmental psychologists. You know, it was crazy. 2 years of crazy interviewing. And it started to look like something that might be a company. We were learning things that were so interesting about what we might do that the idea of actually making a business out of it showed up about halfway through the research. So we launched in 1997 with two series, Rockets New School and Secret Paths. They had the same characters. In one case, we were looking at the social outer self conflicts that we learned about from girls. And in the secret paths case, we were looking at really the inner self-esteem, magic story piece of the whole person. So same characters, different art styles, different game mechanics. We were in the top 500 games, both of them that year. We beat John Madden football. As a Steelers fan, that's especially heartwarming. But so as time went on, eventually our board, which consisted primarily of Paul Allen and cronies, decided that the grass was greener in the internet world, where you didn't need a business plan and your market cap wasn't tied to 10x annual revenue because you didn't have the problem of manufacturing and warehousing, et cetera. So they pulled funding. We had just shipped our eighth title. I had to lay off 60 women, well, 48 women and 12 men. There were mad dashes to the bank to get cash out of our real estate deposit. It was kind of a disaster. So I spent about a year being very angry and writing a very angry book, and then I ritually burned it and spent another half year writing what I think is a helpful book called Utopian Entrepreneur about what I had learned from the experience. So now when I get fan letters from girls who played the games, I send them that book. You know, this is how the sausage was made. And a lot of them will write back and say, you know, I'm a design student at, you know, OCAD or wherever. So I feel like we made a cultural difference, even though we didn't make a lot of money. Oops. So that's that story. It was a transmedia project. I think if you know about it at all, you can see up here we've got stuff that's besides CD-ROMs going on. So, what's the third slide? And
we'll see what else. Oh,
magic crystals.
So this is an example of materiality coming out of the game. So in the Secret Paths games, you chose a girl character who had a problem. They were all together at first in a treehouse, then later on in a lighthouse in the different games. And they'd have problems like, it's, you know, it's father-daughter night at school, and my parents are divorced, and my dad won't come. So if you choose you're going to help that girl, you take out on adventures through the landscape and gather these secret stones that represent qualities that she needs to be mindful of and incorporate in order to deal with her situation. So eventually we extruded those into real stones, and people made each other necklaces and stuff, and it was very cool. And I'll stop there.
Great, thank you. Emma?
Hi, so my name's Emma Westecott. I teach game design and game studies at OCAD University in Toronto. I've been passionate about games since the 80s when I first played our Atari with my mum. And I'd never really noticed that there were games for particular types of players. I just felt as if we could all play and we should all play. In some ways, I'm a bit of a wild card to this panel because I haven't made games for girls. And I think one of the things that I wanted to talk about and unpack is, for me, games are a sort of metaform that can be framed as a technology, can be framed as a design practice, and also as an art practice. And so some of the things I want to sort of talk about really is some of the work that's happening now. As a feminist, I'm interested in promoting diversity and equity in games and the game industry and game culture and affecting real change, because the truth of the matter is things have got worse. We were talking and have been talking about how the 90s were in some ways a much more innocent time when games were still uncool. I remember standing in a pub in London, somebody came up, asked me what I did, and I said I programmed video games, and they turned around and walked away from me. That isn't a problem for my students now. All of my students don't want to be rock stars or filmmakers. They want to be game designers and game makers. And so increasingly we have this problem of how women and girls are often excluded and increasingly excluded from computer science and programming. So I'm sort of interested in looking at things that we can do to open up the industry to a wider sort of set of voices. And one of the things that I wanted, as I sort of talk about, and we're going to talk about this a little bit more in the panel later, is that some of the most interesting work that's happening at the moment comes not necessarily from games as a design practice, but from games as an expressive practice. You know, this notion of game design as a way of developing your own voice and allowing other people to share your experience. And I think that that's one of the sort of key differences in the sort of generations within which we talk. So I think that's all I really wanted to say now.
Yeah, and my name is Megan, and my background is as a documentary and educational filmmaker. And I fluked into games. You know, I knew nothing about the game industry, but I knew how to tell a story and inspired. That's what I was interested in. And I was hired in 97 as creative director at Her Interactive when we first got the Nancy Drew license. And we created our first game, and we took it on the shelves and tried to get it on the shelves. And the publisher said, "I'm sorry, but girls are computer phobic, so we're not going to take your game." And 1 month later, with no warning, the CEO resigned, and I became CEO.
Fast track.
So, you know, the doors were about to close, and I am passionate about Nancy Drew. She inspired me. We can do anything. We're all leaders, we can do anything. She bucked the system, so. And I was raised creatively, so I led creatively. I didn't go to corporate school. I had no financial, technical, or management training whatsoever. And so what we did is creative strategy. We led creatively, and since they wouldn't let us in the front door at retail, we went around back. I found someone to teach us how to publish on Amazon, and the game sales started taking off, and the New York Times dubbed us the un-Barbie of computer games, and interestingly enough, they all came back to do a deal. That's how we got into retail. And then I realized the publisher who we did a deal with was taking the lion's share of the profit, so we did the same thing. We found someone to teach us how to publish on retail, and that's when we took off. So we went from zero to 8.5 million in revenues. We sold 9 million games. We created a new market niche in mystery games for girls. And for a decade, we enjoyed inspired employees, inspired customers, increasing revenues, and for a long time, little competition. And then the economy crashed. I crashed. And you know, it was very hard to pivot. But you know, fortunately we survived. And I left Her Interactive after 15 years, 2 years ago. And I couldn't figure out how we defied the odds in, first of all, a hostile environment, and second of all, with a totally unconventional CEO. And it dawned on me that it was because we bucked the system. The system didn't include us, so we redesigned it. Hi, Celia. So we led with creative intelligence, perception, intuition, imagination, feeling, supported by analytical intelligence, literal, logical, linear thinking, which is how we lead corporately pretty much around the world. And that doesn't necessarily include creative intelligence. And that was a revelation to me because, you know, I mean, I thought the experience was kind of fluky, but then I realized, you know, really that unconscious bias, and we both genders have it, has been that thing holding us back. The corporatization of the business, the corporatization of the games, the lack of diversity in content, and leadership for the past 15 years. And I was really angry when I left the gaming industry, you know, because all I want to do is use the powerful medium of games to inspire us, to enhance, to exalt, to expand what's possible. And that only happens with diverse people and perspectives. And, you know, I believe creativity is the mother of diversity because it is a vehicle to make the perceptual and experiential shift, to lead here and get back in the moment as we were as kids, to truly welcome diverse people and perspectives. So
Great. Thank you so much. So I'm going to go ahead and kick off our first discussion topic for this afternoon. So all of you have sort of touched a little bit on girls' games, and I think that's what we're going to be talking about, of course, a lot. And in particular, you know, how do we define a girl game? What is a girl game? What makes something a girl game? Versus just something that, a game that girls happen to like, right? So I guess maybe I'd like to start by hearing from each of you about what was a girl game or a girl's game or a girly game in the time that you were working or studying in the mid-90s, for example?
Well, I'd like to say that if I had designed games for girls based on my own experience growing up in the 50s and 60s, it would have really sucked. Nobody would have played it. You know, so, for example, the Secret Payoff series, there's all this stuff about how girls like to nurture things. And the girls we interviewed were saying, I want magical creatures to take care of me and give me secret wisdom. It's like, oh, okay, got that. You know, and it just kept turning out that way, that in the design process, we were seeing a diversity and also difference. So we couldn't just say, well, we were once girls, so we know what this is, you know. Things were moving too fast. And as a sidebar to the panel yesterday on players' influence on authored games and the critique of the poor representation of masculinity in games today. No, it was the masculinity panel. I just want to say that, you know, here we are with men, mostly cis white men in all those designer seats, and yet we're getting these flat male characters. And my caution to those of you who know someone like that, is that you can't assume because you're a cis male, you know, working in a game design company that you know what male experiences are like. You still need to go out there and do some research and talk to some people about fishing or the love of the feel of a piece of wood or the love of family or whatever. A lot of things came up. But, you know, even if you think you're the guy you're designing for, you're probably not. So you might as well go find out about them. Anyway, girls' games, as I saw it, we tried to give our games cooties. We didn't want anybody's brother to play them and pronounce them lame, because they were about play patterns and concerns that were expressed much more strongly to us by girls than boys. So the social dynamic structures, in particular, of same-sex groups in girls, quite different from what we saw with boys. Whether that's nature or nurture is beside the point. The fact is that it's there, and we tried to respect it. So for us, it was something that the girl would say, I recognize this. And when we put together the cast of characters, it's like interviewing all these girls all over the country. There's always a bitchy popular girl. There's always, you know, the artist outsider girl. There's always a girl who smokes cigarettes behind the school, you know, which I had to fight for in the game. But it was quite remarkable how these social structures appear to be the same. So a girl would pick up one of these games and say, that's my experience. You know, that's what is going on with me. And we did so much diversity within the cast of characters of girls, racial, cultural, et cetera, economic, that you could identify with somebody in there probably. So that's what I guess would define girls' games as, is something that engages a girl right away, that has to do with her world somehow, is familiar territory, and can take her a step further into working on her own problems. One quick extra thing. We discovered that in those days, and I would guess today still, girls at this middling tween age have this dreadful sense, in general, of social inevitability about what's going on. Oh, I knew they wouldn't invite me. I know I don't look good. I'll never be as smart as her, you know? And so, in a way, the Rocket series was about creating an emotional rehearsal space for making different choices without having big-ass consequences in your own social world. And looking back and looking at the fan mail that I still get, I think that's what was most appreciated by our customers. So it's addressing girls where they are, meeting them where they were, understanding really well where they were, and looking at play patterns that were open, no win, no lose, is another thing that we discovered about girls in that day. I know that audience has changed a lot, but that's how I would define it.
You know, and just adding to what you said, we were talking last night, and Brenda and I realized that we were probably the only two that we know of at the time that actually did the market research and went out and talked to girls to understand their preferences, because at the time, men were making games for themselves. And so it was really a kind of a new practice.
Well, I wouldn't call it market research in our case. And the difference is simply that...
One-on-one usability is what
we're right. So market research and design research use many of the same methods, like interviewing and having people make sketches and stuff. But you do design research at the beginning, you know, before you've even figured out what the plot is. Market research, if you bring the marketing guys in on that, then when it comes time for them to start bitching at you about the game and you get into fist fights, I assume that still happens.
Yeah.
that you can take their hand and say, come with me now back to the research we did together. And it's amazing how many fights that will prevent.
I actually meant one-on-one usability testing or one-on-one testing to find out what they mean. We did a few focus groups, but actually the one-on-ones got us the information we needed much more.
I think for me, girl games express certain visions of femininity. It's not about pink.
Thank God.
It's not about the sort of classic comment about, you know, well, let's make it pink. Let's make this Nintendo device pink. Because actually...
then girls would use it. Let's make pink Legos too.
And, you know, I've been sort of like talking a lot about how do we move away from those really sort of narrow interpretations of femininity. And just to sort of backtrack a little bit, I just want to state that for me, we all exhibit masculine and feminine qualities, right? You know, femininity is not necessarily parallel to being a girl or to being a woman. And also, as we all know, gender is a continuum that shifts over time and over a life course. So our notion of femininity goes in and out of our lived experience. And for me, one of the challenges is thinking about how we respect that femininity in the games that are made available for our girls. And there is a lot of barriers to break down with that, because both boyhood and girlhood have been sort of built as commercial constructs, yeah, if you like, rather than looking at reflecting individual experiences. And so I think that although we're in a very different place in time, we need to celebrate femininity in games and around games. And it's why I think Rachel's work is so important as a way of keeping true and celebrating femininity and experience and not denying that and respecting it, because so often it's a frame which is not respected and not valued within our society in any way at all.
Right, and it's always like a hard line to walk of wanting to say, no, girls don't have to like pink, girls don't have to like fashion, but also like those things are okay and we don't need to throw all those things in the trash,
right,
sort of take them out of the conversation.
I want to add that 30% of our players were boys. Mm-hmm. And the male we got was like, well, we're just trying to figure out how girls work, man.
Yeah. That's true.
That's great.
You know, actually, we kind of had the same thing with Nancy Drew. They would play the games until they're 13, and then it wasn't cool anymore. But we actually got, when we were creating games, we were advised, if you're going to create games for girls, make them pink and they'll all come. So we made them unpink and they all came. So that limited, you know, assumptive thinking that is really what's holding us back. But getting in leadership, but in getting to what are girl games, I kind of find that an odd question. I mean, would they say the same about what are boy games? Boy games, really? You know,
the soup in which we were all swimming, it was just so invisible to the critics.
Yeah. And, you know, to me, girl games are games that respect the preferences of a particular type of girl or girls' audiences. But there are as many preferences as there are girls and women. And we have just begun to scratch the surface to be... you know, expanding the stereotypes that we are locked into, or corporate is locked into that mainstream, and find all the other streams to be able to tell meaningful stories to inspire, because this is giving us a dulling effect you know, it leaves us with that a feeling of a limited and simplistic view of what it is to be human. And not only in the games, but how we feel in work. We only take half of ourselves to work because this is not showing up.
Yeah.
You know, and
Sorry. Yeah, I think that's a really great point. And I wanted to, so you've talked a little bit about, you know, industry practices, and Emma, you as well. I was curious if we could just briefly kind of get your opinions on, you know, we talked about sort of the pink games movement or the girls game movement. And I'm curious to hear from you all just very briefly on sort of like what the industry thought of that movement and what, you know, obviously people within the industry had a certain feeling about it. Journalists had their say on what the pink girls game, you know, pink girls or girls game movement was about. And also sort of like the legacy today, the way that people remember or don't remember that movement. So I'm just curious to see, like, briefly, what were sort of your experiences? How did other developers think about what you were doing, and how did journalists respond? And then, of course, you guys have already mentioned how the players responded,
right,
which was positively, right? But it seems like it wasn't critically accepted the way that it was by your players, and maybe you could speak to that a little bit.
Well, one interesting thing for us is we got this review in the New York Times that said, what the fuck is this? You know, I'm wandering around classrooms in seventh grade trying to figure out who to be friends with. Bleh. And feminists were saying, what the fuck is this? These girls like fight and they're petty and steal each other's diaries. Bleh. And I'm thinking, yes! You know, we have offended just the right people.
Yes, you made me think of this New York Times reporter called me in the beginning and said, I just want to ask you, and it was an interview, but it was his last question, why make games for girls? And you know, I stopped for a second. I couldn't believe he asked the question. And I said,
it was always that question.
And I said, that, you know, my mind was like, what an idiot, you know. But my response was, we're 51% of the population. That's a silly question to ask. But that's their mindset. And it wasn't just him, they all had it. And they believed that pink games need to be there. You know, we need all of them because we're all different. But they believed that that would satisfy girls because, and you know, their impressions of women and girls as inferior, and you know, it just they couldn't help it. It was unconscious, really.
Well, there was a kind of a bias just broadly held in the game industry in those days that girls would not play games. And part of that legacy comes from an Activision game in 1986 that used Barbie. You're nodding, you know about this.
Right.
So. Right, so the mechanic was Barbie's pelting people with marshmallows at the mall. So I asked one of the developers, I was working at Activision at the time, so what are you thinking here? He says, well, girls aren't very good with trajectory, and we think marshmallows move more slowly through space. It's like physics, you know? But that story got told so often that it became the truth, that girls don't play games. You know, and it's a self-fulfulling prophecy.
It seemed, too, like there was this thing where developers would say, well, girls don't have any game literacy, so we're going to make the game easy so that they'll succeed and have fun. But a game that's easy usually isn't fun, and then it gives girls a certain impression about what games are like, then they don't play them, then they don't have any game literacy for the next generation,
it's
a cyclical.
That's, you know, well said.
That's very good, and it's a good example of that is when we were creating the first game, Microsoft got interested for whatever reason, because they really weren't, I don't think, but anyway, they brought us there to play test, you know, with the girls, and we, you know, did exploratory, and girls like to examine things, and they were actually talking to the girls, which you're not supposed to do at the time, and influencing them because they really thought it should be fast-paced, because that's the way they thought games should be, and male-oriented, and it seems true over the years, over my 15 years, that men are shaping the vision of the technology, and we're an afterthought that just, you know, and if we're not complying with the way in which the games are created, they can't see the possibility of something completely different for a completely different audience.
Well, and here's some more sausage. Jill Barad, the chairman of Mattel, was on the board of Microsoft. And basically what Mattel did was acquire almost every single girl game company and drive a stake through its heart to protect their Barbie franchise. So there's a little footsie going on in the boardroom here, too.
Hey. Yeah. Hey.
And I think that's one of the things that's really
important. The learning company, by the way.
Yeah. I think it's one of the things that's really important is it's easy to forget that the work that both of the people that I'm surrounded by did was really important and significant and is being erased from the sort of history of games. I mean, Games for Girls sort of predate a lot of, certainly sort of theoretical and sort of critical engagement with games, and those histories aren't being taught. So again, we see situations where, you know, really important work done in an industry by women is being rubbed out of the histories that are being taught to young women today. So we're still in a situation where young women feel the games aren't for them.
And much of the time.
Yeah, yeah. Which is really problematic because, you know, the numbers of women, you know, coming into computer science, coming into programming, coming into games making go down because they don't see it as a form that's for them.
Right. And I guess, too, when you have, I mean, you guys have brought up great points, is like when these companies get bought up and the franchises get, you know, pushed together or sort of erased from history
or murdered,
right? I mean, one consequence is we don't have things like series reboots. We don't have nostalgic t-shirts with brand names and logos on them the way that, you know, you can walk down the street and see someone wearing an Atari logo t-shirt today. And there's this like sort of idea of reboot nostalgia that gets lost when these companies you know, die out or get bought up, that they don't have IP to even sell merchandise anymore. And I mean, not that merchandise is, you know, super important, but it's one of those things that sort of lets us remember the legacy of something that's not around anymore.
We had a t-shirt that I could get rich selling. We did gender signaling studies during our interview, so we were figuring out, like, okay, if a truck is pink and fuzzy, is it for a boy or a girl? Pinkness and fuzziness override truckness, so now we're starting to see if a diary has a bullet hole in it, is it for a boy or a girl? Boys are saying, no, that's a fucking diary. You know? If Echo the Dolphin has bleeding fangs, it's for boy. You know, so we started getting this branding hierarchy. Well, one of the best t-shirt we had was called Battle Hair Barbie, where we dressed Barbie up in G.I. Joe's clothing, and that was the toy that nobody wanted. Nobody wanted it. The boys were, they hated the hair, the girls hated it again, and everybody thought that vacant blue-eyed stare out from under the helmet was just like weird. I could still sell that. I could sell that in the Castro in a heartbeat.
That's amazing. So I think this is actually a really good segue to kind of talking about, you know, we talked about some of the challenges with it, with the industry at the time, but I'd like to get your opinions on how the legacy of this is sort of maybe informing what's happening today, and, you know, what's in store for the future of girl games. Do we still need girl games? Is there work that touches on femininity or girlhood that you feel somehow carries a legacy of the work that is being done, or do we need something different for the future? What do you guys think?
I think that one of the most interesting things I see happening in games is games that are being made with a quite correct sort of assumption or hope that we're working in a post-gender world, and that actually all of a sudden we can get out of particular sort of gender stereotypes, but we live in a particular society, and why should we police femininity in the context of sort of freedom of expression? And one of the points I wanted to make is there's no boundaries in games. You know, there's no reason why one type of game should dominate over a different type of game. And if we're really pushing for diversity of experience, there should be a place for girl games moving forward, because as we sort of, as we've spoken about, there are many different types of girls, in the same way as there are many different types of women. And in order to sort of try and address the richness of the human experience, we need to sort of celebrate a real range of different types of games. So I think whilst we don't necessarily, and we were talking a little bit about this, you know, what is a girl game today? Who's making the girl games today? And I think that you can see examples of games that exhibit and celebrate femininity in the Indian DIY game making space that are really rich. And
trans women are making them.
Yeah. Yeah, and so I guess what I'm trying to say is, I know when my daughter plays games, she doesn't play girl games, she plays Minecraft. And I think what's really interesting is thinking about different types of platforms that allow for a multitude of play styles and allow for that sense of identity and exploration. And I think that's part of the seduction of that particular platform, that particular sort of sandbox. But that doesn't mean that feminine games shouldn't be made. And I think we are seeing them operate in particular sort of spaces, but I would like to sort of, I'd like to see more of that work, and I'd like to see more of that work sort of celebrated within the sort of indie and DIY spaces.
It's funny, we're all saying kind of the same thing in different ways, which is great. I'm optimistic because there's been such a shift, you know, where there's been such a wake-up call over the past couple of years. That we are leading with the values of one gender is appalling. And the only way we're going to unstall the culture, the gaming industry, is to embrace the values of creativity, which is, you know, love, kindness, curiosity, and leading that way to welcome people to feel safe enough to genuinely collaborate, to share their unique experiences and their stories. And it's happening. Leadership, corporate leadership, knows it is broken, and they don't know how to fix themselves and their practices. So the creativity, and now the science of creativity is proven, because they used to relegate it, and probably still do, to making art or products, right? But it's I believe it's our human operating system, because it accesses all domains of knowing. Mm. It uses all of our senses, not just this. And I've actually, so I'm optimistic. I think that this is the turning point of, you know, the indies are doing it, leading the way, and they know it, and they buy them up and then change the culture and it doesn't work anymore. So they have to change, and you know, women are a great market. Actually, I heard today that they're the only ones being funded now, right? So I'm very optimistic that we're gonna start to see more diversity in and creative thinkers in leadership, and that they will finally have the courage to get the support they need to make that experiential and perceptual shift, because it's unconscious bias. And, you know, it's a blind spot and a bad habit we all have, and because it's unconscious, we don't know we actually have it.
If I might interject, I also think that, in a way, the girl games movement was perhaps the progenitor of the LGBTQ games movement, yes. of our willingness and our bravery and generosity in deconstructing the gender binary in the work that we do. It can't be anything more important than that. And so, in my view, I think the torch has been passed to queer games and expressive games that are written by, quote, non-standard, non-traditional, marginal people, because, I mean, you talk about the men who are making and funding games. It's not, it's like that, you remember that prisoner that got frozen and they made him into like 200 slices? There's a little slice of a guy somewhere that's doing the funding and the making. But it's not a whole person.
That's right.
It's not embracing the notion of a whole person. And the courage and generosity of spirit of the LGBTQ community has just totally impressed me that it is possible not only to change games, but to change the whole construct of gender in our society.
Mm-hmm. Very well said. Yeah. Are there any makers, any indie devs that, or any games that you feel really address those issues? Like you mentioned queer games, and you guys, I think, all mentioned indie games. Any creators that come to mind are
Squinky. Yay! Squinky certainly has won my heart.
Cara Stone, Merritt Kopis. There's so much rich work, Christine Love. There's so much amazing work going on in that space. And I think that one of the question now becomes, how do we support these makers so that they can eat and survive and continue? And that's something which is never going to come from a mainstream industry necessarily. It's going to come from the wider sort of social context of games. And you know, we're all gamers now, right? You know, and so one of the things we were talking about is this notion of multiple niches. You know, actually, you were talking about testing within micro niches. So maybe we're in a situation where rather than making games for girls, we're making games for girls from a particular place and time, you know. So what would happen to, you know,
historical
women? Not necessarily historically. I mean, if you're making games for girls in poverty-stricken areas outside of Chicago, how do you deliver those games? How do you fund them? Well, there's Kickstarter, thank God. I think a lot of good stuff has been funded by crowdsourced funding. But I think the point we were talking about this morning was, if you're making, say, a trans game, a male to female trans game, a game about that person's experience, and you have 10,000 players, that will keep you fed, you know, probably. And so this notion of having to have a blockbuster every time, it might be a false limitation.
Yeah.
I don't know.
You know, speaking of just supporting each other and mentorship, I mean, IndieCade is like the cornerstone of that. This is such a welcoming and supportive environment, and it's changing things. And, you know, regarding the corporate leadership, it's very clear. People are leaving in droves, no longer putting up with the way they're treated, and people really need to be inspired, not managed. So. And I think what we're getting at too is that, you know, when they're inspired, inspiration feeds us meaning that gives us the purpose to create for a higher purpose. And each one of we all have unique creativity. Mine's different from yours, it's different from yours. And the wisdom and that innate creativity has to come from within. And if we're given the power or the, not the power, we have the power.
Take it.
But given the environment, yes, take it. And it is ours to change. So I think one person at a time, collectively, this is a creative revolution.
I just will say, this young woman here has tales that will curl your hair about the corporate environment and the environment of peers that she's had to deal with.
Yeah.
And so, on the one hand, you can be an indie gamer and put your whole life into it and find your resources, and that's all good. But this woman is a stayer. She's stayed where people were trying to kick her butt out of the situation, and she's continued to be productive, and that is probably the best thing.
That
it just makes
courage.
My day.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you so much to all of you, and we've got about 15 minutes left, so I'd like to take this opportunity to have our panelists answer all of your burning questions. So if you have a question, please raise your hand high. There you go.
Company to
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know.
Well, I think you're absolutely right. I think that it was a kind of a happy happenstance that we had this sort of Mata Hari-like silhouette that we that we could all become very familiar with. And I don't think that was the grand strategic goal of those games. Those games were about learning certain things, and that the persona that was chosen, I mean, she didn't look like Barbie in a spy outfit, you know, but she was a she. I don't think that made it a girl game, but I think a lot of us felt very familiar with what was going on there because there was a lead character who was female identified.
Does that answer your question?
Liz?
Well, I think it's a mistake to ignore history, whether you agree with it or not. Like, I don't agree with Hitler, but I probably need to know some stuff about the Second World War, you know. in the day when I was working, for example, male programmers had very poor personal hygiene on, you know, as a rule. I don't see that now. But have the conversations with us. That's the way to bridge the gap. Grab people like us oldies and, you know, talk to the wrinklies and let's work some stuff out here, because we may find out that we don't disagree as much as stereotypical thinking would suggest.
And I think it's important as well to find a way of facilitating that intergenerational discussion, because we don't necessarily have to agree about our politics, but we do have to build coalitions to effect change, to create better environments for you to make the games that you want to make. And I think that I know certainly from my own point of view, I have a significant amount of privilege. I have a faculty position, I get paid a wage to do that. So I spend a lot of my time thinking, well, how can I use my privilege in the groups that I work with to try and create opportunities and spaces? And I don't know the answer to that type of question, except that it starts in dialogue and it starts in respect and conversation and openness. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there'll always be idiots everywhere who don't listen to each other. But there's a woman called Rosie Brodotti who talks a lot, a feminist who talks a lot about affirmative politics and how we can set up situations where we can be generous with each other and we can find ways forward. Because, and this is one of the things that Refig is about, and I just wanted to name check that a little bit, because thanks to the very wonderful, generous Canadian government, we've got 5 years of funding to try and look at pushing back against some of the marginalization and inequity that sort of goes on.
And a prime minister with a tattoo.
He's very pretty, isn't he? some reverse sexism going on.
Sorry.
But so I think I understand that there's been lots of violence caused against women in different community groups by women themselves, by people who identify as feminists, and that's something which I think is hugely problematic. But as I don't think those feminists or the feminists sat on this particular stage, and I think that we have to find ways of talking in order to build the momentum to create a better environment for everybody. So it's a bit sort of fluffy, but I think that I think that we can talk.
And not to mention, as you guys brought up before, is like feminists didn't like your games, right? Like,
the radical lesbian separatists that I initially hired to work as my development team just about ate me alive, because I've always been an equity feminist, and so there was difficulty in the studio. There was trouble on the ranch.
even within like that one generation or one wave, there's still so many different approaches and angles, mm-hmm. and it's almost like there was even no consensus to start with. Mm-hmm. And did you want to add something as well?
No, we didn't have that particular problem, but we had other problems.
Well, I went away on vacation once for a couple of days, and when I came back, the character boards were on the wall, and as a joke, I think, they had redesigned all the characters to look like 8-year-old angry dykes on motorcycles. And, you know.
Can we have that game?
Yeah, right. Please. I was like, you guys, how much time did you waste on it? But it was hilarious. It was hilarious.
Another question. Yes, in the hat.
Well, you know, it wasn't an intentional thing. It was an organic thing because, you know, I was a filmmaker, moved to Seattle without a job, got offers from Microsoft because they thought they wanted to do content. Thank God they changed their mind. It was not creatively collaborative at all, so I left. And when I had the opportunity to lead a company, I decided to co-create the opposite of Microsoft culture. And so that's how we attracted both men and women and ethnic diversity. We had it all because we had an environment that everybody wanted to come to. And the guys were as much into Nancy Drew as the women. And it was just such a positive environment that girls, you know, would come for tours and we'd have them speak with all the we'd get like drop everything, have 6 people speak with them, so if you know a girl can see it, she can be it, and to make them experience their potential. And they honestly left a foot taller. So it happened not because we put a quota, which I think are you know band-aids that really don't work.
I like quotas.
Well, you know. I mean, women often get sidestepped when the decisions get made. You know, if you're just saying, okay, I got those kind of women.
Well, and also, you didn't take them down to the basement where all the male programmers were chained to the wall.
No, that's right. True. That's true. But did that answer your question?
Was there another question? Did you have a question?
Just kidding, Megan. Kidding.
Sorry, CIM? In the... Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Kitty.
Where's the cat?
Let's call her Kitty from now on.
I wanted to kind of ask a question and also on this question girls. So one is we've seen all of these again from queer games and games like Gone Home, which has been a huge hit with everybody.
Well, one of the things I'll try not to subject everybody to this too long. I've just finished a PhD thesis, which took a whole lot of time. And one of the things that was interesting about that for me was coming out with this sort of notion that there's a continuum between sort of like gender-free game design and drag at the other opposition. And so we can sort of maybe sidestep some of the issues about the hypersexualization of all game characters, whether they be presented as male or female, by looking at using that continuum as a design prompt. And, you know, there are a bunch of games that manage to avoid gender. Journey, for example, although I must admit I was upset in some ways when I realized that the character was originally meant to be female and then got stepped back into a removal of gender signifiers in an attempt to move towards a universality of a sort of appeal and attraction. But I think that there are a bunch of games that put forward sort of characters that are gender-free in terms of how they're or what they're signifying. And I think at the other end we have characters like Bayonetta that actually are so hyper-exaggerated in their sort of in the way that she represents gender, I would say that Bayonetta is much more of a drag act than she is either female or male per se. And I think that gives us a different lens to think about how we want to sort of design the characters that we play through. And thinking about it as a performance allows us to sort of play with gender rather than sort of just sort of like tie into particular gender stereotypes.
Yeah. So again, this emotional rehearsal space idea shows up. You know, that, well, what is this life like? This character who's not like me. And, you know, otherwise we wouldn't have the success of stuff like Orange is the New Black, you know, showing up on television, because there is curiosity about the life of the other. That doesn't do a terrific job as a series, but, you know, it's an example. And also, as you were saying before, the constructivist games like Minecraft and the pure puzzle games like Tetris or Monument Valley, you know, all that whole domain tends not to focus on gender. So I think we really get into it when we have a narrative driving the situation, and then that's when it gets hard.
I think we have time for one more question. Yeah? Yes, in the back.
I'm going to be working with 2 to 4-year-olds pretty soon, I think, on a research project that may involve games. But I don't know. I really don't know. You know what? As a newbie in game design again, since so much time has passed, I'm also working on a Twine game that's really pretty autobiographical and expressive. And that's where I kind of need to start. Mm-hmm. So.
I think I would make a game for girls and women, and interestingly, we thought we were targeting girls 9 through 13 for Nancy Drew, but it actually became a cross-generational phenomenon because the games were challenging enough for everyone, and moms were inspired by Nancy Drew, so they bought it for their daughters, they got hooked, they gave it to their moms, so I think we need more and more diverse games. And that's the area I would go.
And did we?
I never made games for girls, so I can't answer that question.
But if you did,
I'd love to make a game for a particular girl in a particular community, but I don't think we can make total statements about what a girl is or what a woman is. And so I think that means that I don't think I'd attempt anything that ambitious.
Well, I think, you know, the trick, as it has always been, and it's a harder trick now, is that we're really working in a space where the story of a game you play is a narrative of a mediated collaboration between a designer and a player or a group of players, and that we can only work indirectly to have people making interesting or less interesting choices. So the trick then is in the situation and the form and the mechanic and looking at what emerges there. I don't know if I'm making any sense here. Doesn't look like, okay, I'll stop.
I think that's a perfect place to end.
Stop making sense.
Let's give a hand to our wonderful panelists today. Thank you.